The Old Testament reading for the third Sunday in Advent is written in the 61st chapter of Isaiah, beginning at the first verse. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, and to provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God. For he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the soil makes the sprouts come up, and a garden causes seeds to grow, so the Sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel is written in the first chapter of St. John, beginning at the 6th verse. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Now this was John's testimony when the Jews of Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Christ." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the desert, make straight the way for the Lord." Now some Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany on the other side of the Jordan, where John was baptizing. Here endeth the gospel. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. To the shepherds, as they watched tonight, as I was explaining to the kids, the shepherd's candle. And it reminds us then of God's love for all mankind, for everyone. You might have wondered about the song as we're singing it. A great tune. This is also the tune, of course, to On Jordan's Bank, the Baptist Cry, which we're probably most familiar to. But if you look over the left there, this is actually a hymn by Luther. And then you'll see it says TR, which means translated by Richard Massey in 1854. And so this hymn was originally in German. And this is one of those hymns I've talked about before where you're singing along and you go, "That's a nice rhyme, that's a nice rhyme, that's a nice rhyme, dud." What happened? Well, so verse 2. Let's go. Two shepherds as they watched by night appeared a host of angels bright. Nice rhyme. "Behold the tender babe," they said, "in yonder lowly manger lay." Laid. So you see what they did there? They couldn't rhyme it, so they did what? They got at least the same letters. S-A-I-D, L-A-I-D, right? It's at least the same letters, but it doesn't rhyme. Why does that happen? They're translating, trying to do the best they can, translating from a German hymn into English, and they can't always. You have to always ask yourself, do I express the rhyme, or do I keep the meaning? And you're always confronted with these things when you're translating from one language to another. We heard last week at Bethlehem, in David's town, as Micah did of old, make known. Town known. There you go, another one, right? At least they got the right letters. "'Tis Jesus Christ, your Lord and King, who doth to all salvation bring." But does, it's old English for does, to all salvation bring. Christ is the Savior of all. The shepherd's candle reminds us of that fact. And so the hymn goes on rejoicing in this. "Oh, then rejoice that through his Son, God is with sinners now at one." All sinners? Yes. All sinners. Okay. "Made like yourselves of flesh and blood, your brother is the eternal God." I don't know what to do with that one, so they don't get the same letters. I guess they could have said the eternal good, maybe got the same letters, but again, the rhyme falls a little flat. But this notion of him becoming one of us, the incarnation, which we're celebrating at his birth. As we said in the creed, for us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Virgin Mary. Made your brother and mine. This has wonderful implications, of course. This hymn brings out the implications of, that means that we're reconciled with God, that God's great love for us, that he would become one of us. But it also, the author of Hebrews makes a point from the incarnation, that Jesus also understands what it is to be human, and he understands what it is to go through life, right? To go through life. Jesus was hungry. Jesus was thirsty. Jesus wept. Jesus felt pain. Jesus felt sorrow. Your brother. Taking these things on that he might redeem you, pay for your sins. So, it goes on. He rejoices in what harm can sin and death then do? The true God now abides with you. Emmanuel, right? God with us. But not just with us in any old way, but with us on our side, for us. Made like yourselves of flesh and blood. Oh, sorry, I got the wrong verse here. Let hell and Satan rage and chafe. Christ is your brother, and you are safe. And the only weapon Satan has is our sin. Right? The only weapon he has is our sin against us, really. I mean, that he can recall to our minds our sinfulness. And that has been taken away simply in this fact that God doesn't see that anymore. When he looks at us, he sees Christ and his righteousness. So verse 5, not one he will or can forsake who him his confidence doth make. Let all his wiles the tempter try, you may his utmost powers defy. Now we got all nice rhyme there, didn't we? Amen. But yes, the wiles of the tempter can no longer, he can cause issues in our life, but ultimately, finally, he is defeated. God's verdict of us who are in Christ Jesus is innocent. Our Lord has paid for our sins. And so the last verse says, you shall and must at last prevail. God's own ye are, you cannot fail. That's right. To God forever sing your praise with joy and patience all your days. And we need the patience because it doesn't always look this way. We were talking about in Bible class today some of the now not yet stuff. Holy Scripture. We are fully and completely saved in Christ now, in the sense of God views us in Christ Jesus, seeing what Christ has done for us. He looks at Jesus' perfect work in our behalf. He applies it to us, and he sees us in the light of Christ. And yet, not yet, we still want to walk through this veil of tears, this, the shadow of death, with our own sin. We remain sinners. We remain, what we confessed a few moments ago, our sinfulness and our uncleanness. And we wait then for the restoration of all things, salvation in the greater sense, when everything is restored. We looked at Romans in there where Paul looks even longs for the redemption of our bodies, that these, which are really part of us, who we are, made who we are, will be redeemed and perfected better than ever. Tell me, the older I get, the more I look forward to that. As the body doesn't always cooperate with you anymore as you get older. You know what I'm talking about, right? You're older. Yeah. This great message of Christmas, of the incarnation of Christ coming in our behalf. And he does not despise his creation. He became one of us. The incarnation ought to remind us of that and how God works, that he works in ways that are what I like to call counterintuitive. They don't appear to be the way you would normally work. This babe that we're celebrating in a few days, his birth, is the same one who will go to the cross on Calvary for our sins. And he will pay for them with laying down his perfect life in our place, that we have complete and total forgiveness. Not how you and I would probably have done it, but how God in his great love and mercy did do it. For you and for me, for the shepherds, and for everyone. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus always.